All right, we are live now.
We are live.
Welcome to the first episode of the Cash Cycle. We've got special guest Ross Gerber-Kawasaki and Roger Ver here to discuss the pros and cons of Bitcoin.
So Roger Ver is a early adopter of Bitcoin and a very prominent angel investor in many of the Bitcoin startups that you see around us today. And recently, he started Bitcoin.com, which is a very informative site for anyone that's new to Bitcoin. So if you check out Bitcoin.com, it has all the basics that you need to know to get acquainted with it better.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah. Okay. Can you guys
hear me? So, want to intro.
So Gerber? Ross Gerber-Kawasaki is a hedge fund manager and frequent commentator on CNBC. He's got a lot more knowledge about some of the regulatory hurdles Bitcoin actually faces in the macroeconomic marketplace, and he's going to discuss that end of things for us here today. So, Ross, we're going to start off probably on the topic of anonymity and some things that are recent developments in the media going on, you know, in France, and, you know, terrorism and funding along the lines of anonymity in the digital cash market.
Yeah. So, I'm sure all of you have seen that recent headlines after the whole Paris thing was that they are trying to link ISIS and the terrorists from getting some of their funding through Bitcoin. So after that, that's kind of created a whole offshoot of fears and possible regulatory action against Bitcoin. What are you guys' thoughts on that?
Well, if you want to start with AML laws and sort of the basic problem that Bitcoin faces due to terrorist financing and drug dealers, is not per se that Bitcoin itself is so bad or good, is that bad people look for places to manipulate for their own good. And Bitcoin is uniquely suited for these uses. And so the terrorists are using Bitcoin. They are, and it's a very effective tool for them.
How do you know that, Ross?
Because the fact that they work so much on cell phones and to be able to transfer money cell phone to cell phone, they're very, very sophisticated. They absolutely get Bitcoin, the internet, and everything.
The show, I saw on Twitter that the most recent terrorists in France, they were using their own personal cell phones and non-encrypted normal text messages, and they were using their personal credit cards.
So they also blew themselves up. So they don't usually send the really smart ones to do that. So the smart ones send the other guys, but that's why the guy left his fucking cell phone in the trash can, you know. So thank God. But you can't help the fact that other people want to exploit what Bitcoin is great at. So the way the laws work in the transference of money, it's so strict and regulated. And the expectation of knowing source of funds, as well as, like, you know, who the client is, and signing off personally that we verify that to be able to take deposits, creates a huge burden for Bitcoin that, with the existing systems the way they are, why would you want to even deal with
it? So, I mean, there's a couple of points there. First of all, the media reports that were going on that ISIS was using Bitcoin was actually all unfounded. It was anonymous sort of unverified sources reporting, you know, to other sources, and then this was got into the media.
I believe that.
It's the ideal time for a shitstorm, you know. Let's go blaming encryption. Like, it's a big agenda now, isn't it, of course?
Absolutely.
So
they don't want it, though. They don't want it, and so they have an agenda.
So then the other problem is that, I mean, all things considered, Bitcoin is so small, you know, the markets are so small and so illiquid, it's just impossible and infeasible that an organization like ISIS, you know, which is dealing in hundreds of millions of dollars, could you know, be using Bitcoin. It's actually sublime to ridiculous.
So, no. What your point is very valid if you think of it on a big scale. But if you think of it on an operational scale of just funding a specific terrorist act in smaller dollars, it's very effective. I think you can't look at it as like, oh, they're using Bitcoin. It's not that. Mm-hmm. It's if they use Bitcoin at all, it's a problem.
So
it's more a problem than using cash.
Mm-hmm. Because that's what they use already. They use cash. But nobody's outlawing their own cash because they print the cash every day. They need the cash.
I mean, a lot of times I hear, you know, illicit black market activities is justification to end Bitcoin. You know, use it for drugs, the black market. But cash is used for all of the same things that they want to say Bitcoin is a terminal because of.
Yeah, but you have to
understand. And, I mean, that can't be the basis for it.
You have to understand, it's the government's cash. The government prints that money. They don't care. It's their money. You know, see, this is the analogy I like to use with Bitcoin people because I think what you're trying to do is great. Okay? I get this whole idea. But when you took over a country like in 1500, you killed a lot of people to take over your country. And the first thing you did was you had your own language and your own money. Okay? And so, like, and your own religion, if you were really smart. And then what you did was you create control. And so all the big governments of the world own their money, and they don't want you to change that. Like, especially like China, for example. They put capital controls on, and people use Bitcoin. That's why it rallied, because they're like, oh, we could use Bitcoin, and 10 guys start using it, and it goes crazy. And the Chinese government are like, all right, you're in jail. You're in jail. How do you fix that?
So your criticism isn't so much, from what I'm hearing, that, you know, oh, Bitcoin can be used for terrorism per se. It's that it's not the thing that governments control, and therefore it becomes a target for KYC AML, you know, under that guise.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So the issue is that what you got, like, your whole community and the concept is to have a global community that usurps governments, because we're all in different places in the world right now, and quite frankly, most of the governments are total idiots, okay? So, like, the governments have gotten dumber in the world than they've ever been. I mean, like, it's crazy, right? Mm-hmm. And so smart people are like, let's create this virtual world, right? They don't want your virtual money, okay? But they have guns and stuff and jails and torture. And you're not willing to die for it. So that's a problem.
Roger, so at the very least, though, I think
Roger,
we should...
can you weigh in on this?
Go ahead.
Roger, can you weigh in on this?
Yeah, actually, I want to say, I think at the very least, we should take a step back and think about what this is here. So here we are, a bunch of people around the world that want to use Bitcoin, something right. That wasn't created by any government.
Right.
And when you talk about government, what these are people that none of us have probably never met in the vast majority of cases. And these are, so they're strangers to us.
Who?
And they're a threat.
The government?
People that work in government.
No.
People that write the law.
People in government every day. They're not strangers. You can walk into the
office. Let's get this point out. I want to hear Roger's point. Let's see what you got.
Sorry.
So my point is that I go out of my way not to meet these people because I'm scared of them. Because these are strangers that are willing to use guns and jails and violence on other people that are just trying to use a peaceful tool, and they're willing to send people to jail and use violence against them. And like, if you or I, if I sent a letter to a regulator and said, hey, you have to get my permission to do your job, and you have to get a license from me and pay me money every year, they would think I was a nutcase for sending them a letter like that. But the governments do the exact same thing. They send letters to strangers in the mail demanding money and demanding that we get their permission to do things. It's the exact same craziness, but all of us went through all this schooling, usually in government schools, where they say, oh, you have to obey the government. The government's the boss. The government's in control of everything. Without the government, everything would fall apart. But, you know, I don't believe that anymore, especially with the internet. We can all get along just fine without having people living in far-off cities telling us how we live our lives and demanding that we get their permission to live our lives. To me, that whole thing is crazy, and Bitcoin is one of the most powerful tools imaginable to separate ourselves from the control of these people that we've never met.
So I think Roger actually brings up a very good point. So one thing is that, so before, like, if you really do think about it, how governments operate and what they try and the methods that they use to actually, like tax and prison and stuff, before it wasn't as big of a deal because not many people actually realized and kind of thought about it. But with the spread of internet, what's happening is that everything is becoming more transparent and people are actually learning. And once they actually find out what the government is kind of doing, then they start to understand that it's not that great. So as we see the proliferation of information, we start seeing people realize, oh, shit, maybe we should try something else because what's going on right now is not so great.
Or another really, really simple idea is that individuals cannot delegate to somebody else a right that that individual doesn't have to begin with. And so if you can't delegate a right that you don't have yourself, where does government get its authority to do all these things that no individual could do? So if you or I got together and told everybody else that they have to serve in our army and give us half their income every year, we would be considered psychopaths. Yet somehow government does those exact same things, and supposedly they get their right to rule from the consent of the governed, but that's a lie. Like if it's consensual, then it's not government, and if it's government, it's not consensual, and you can't delegate a right that you don't have. So the end of that chain of logic there is that government is illegitimate. It doesn't have a right to do something that individuals can't do. And I think more and more people are starting to think about that. And
I have to address this, okay? When I was a kid, my parents took me to Africa, okay? We went on safari. I was a little kid. I'm going in this van, and I'm looking at the animals, and there's this really, really cool-looking deer. And I'm like, man, this thing is awesome. It's a beautiful gazelle. And out of nowhere, a lion came and fucking ate it. Killed it and tore it apart right in front of me and took it back, and his kids ate it, and it was actually the woman. The man lion was just chilling.
You're gonna get scary.
Okay? And what I learned was that the world is not that nice of a place. What you're talking about isn't life. Okay? Life is a very rough and dangerous place. Okay, I lived in West Philadelphia, and I lived in Bel Air. You know, I've lived in the nicest place in the world and the worst crap hole. And I can tell you, life isn't that easy or nice. So people will kill you for $5, okay, right down the street from me. And I live in a nice area, okay? So we're in a world where people are murdered every day. And so we live in America. Now, I'm from the 60s mentality of we can change the government. I believe that if everybody tries, we could get Barack Obama to be president over Hillary Clinton and all those effing Republicans, and we got him as president. It didn't work out, but we got him in there. Now, who do you want to be president? Because that's what I'm working on right now, is to make sure the right person wins. Now, I have no good choices, but people like
me... I think you're still in the wrong paradigm. Why do you need a president? Why do you need someone to boss you around?
Because we live in America where everything you want exists. Have you ever been to Burning Man?
That's not because of the president. Everything exists and is wonderful in different countries around the world, not because of the head of that government.
Have you been to Coachella? It's utopia. There is that world. It's America. The world you want is this country. We fought for it. We fought for this country. Okay? So, like, why can't it be the world you want here? I made it. I made it happen. Nobody bothers me. I have lawyers. What are they going to do to me?
What do you mean nobody bothers you? Try not paying your taxes and see what happens to you.
I pay my share because I have to.
Why do you pay? Because men with guns will come to your house, take your house, and put you in jail if you don't.
My house caught on fire once. And the firemen came and saved my house. It was the best day of my life that they saved my house.
What does that have to do with government in Texas?
I pay them. I pay these guys.
There are no government shoe factories if you managed to have shoes. I'm sure there would still be firemen if there weren't government fire agencies.
This is my choice. I chose this one.
So what about the people that don't want
this? I guess what I was saying is we have an architecture in place that exists because the status quo has been accepted. And what he's saying is that with the proliferation of information, that a new status quo
should be overthrowing this government. We should be getting rid of these people.
There you go, Ross. I like what you're saying now.
Ross, keep saying that, you'll end up in jail.
No, I'm not, because I'm doing it through the system that we created. That George
Washington...
We didn't
create anything. It was imposed upon us. It existed before you were born. And think about this. The United States Constitution...
Here with nothing.
The United States Constitution, which supposedly gave government the right to tax and control everything, that was signed by a bunch of guys... that none of those people...
These are our ancestors.
Hold on. Let me make the point here. So the people that signed the Constitution didn't have the right to control or tax or do any of this stuff that they do, yet somehow they got together and wrote down these words on paper, delegating a right that none of them have had to begin with to the government to do these things? That's crazy talk. That's magical law.
I didn't really follow it, you know. So, if you read Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution,
okay, but I think we should get back on point, not because this isn't a good conversation, but what we really want to talk about is monetary issues, because the fact is that the government's going to do what they need to do to protect themselves, and so you, what you're trying to do is in direct opposition of the most powerful people in the world. And that's the challenge that
But Ross, let me come in here for a second. What we're trying to do is just, we're trying to do something peaceful. What the government is trying to do is something forceful and violent.
Right.
Yeah, so who's it, so who's in the right and who's in the wrong?
But it doesn't matter when you get eaten.
But what it does matter is that one's peaceful, one's violent, but the peaceful thing cannot be stopped because it's distributed. Therefore, in the end, it will ultimately win.
I think I don't disagree with what you're saying. But the world isn't that nice, so somebody has to die for this to work. Do you see what I'm saying?
I agree with Ross on that. Like, the world is the universe is not a nice place. There's a lot of death for the value that's left in the system. A lot of stuff dies for what we have to enjoy. That's true in all spheres, you know. What I do want to move the conversation to is, what is exactly Bitcoin? You know, is it actually money? Is it a commodity? Is it a digital store of value? Because I think the definition of Bitcoin is not well understood either, because it functions as many things, also along the lines of a medium of exchange.
You know what? I think we should try and get Ross's point of what he thinks Bitcoin is, because he's kind of an outsider, right? Because we've been immersed in the whole Bitcoin world. So let's hear what Ross... What do you think that Bitcoin is, coming from where you're coming from, and based on what people are thinking around you? If I asked you, what is Bitcoin, what would you say?
Honestly, I think maybe everybody's getting scammed, and whoever made up Satoshi, it just pushes a button and all your money disappears. You've got $7 billion. It would be genius. But that's a movie. I like that as a movie. Now, what I think Bitcoin is that whatever storehouse of value that you create as your medium, whether it's Microsoft credits, you know, this was a byproduct of trading virtual video game things. You know, like, so if I log on to Microsoft, I can convert my dollars into Microsoft credits and buy a virtual hammer, and then from virtual hammers it went to virtual money. And the same people created Bitcoin and the exchanges and stuff that were creating the digital exchanges for virtual goods. And so it's a great idea, okay? So we'll have digital money and we'll standardize it, okay? So if you're gonna have a finite amount of Bitcoins, which is basically what the idea is, it's like gold, okay? So Bitcoin, in my mind, is digital gold. You guys struck digital gold, okay? So that's why everybody thinks the potential is it could go in value to 20,000, okay? Or even if it went to 2,000. But it could go up in value because there's a limit to supply that's imposed upon it, okay? So gold is technically a commodity, okay? But it's mostly because it's also used in other things where Bitcoin can't be. So there's no demand destruction with Bitcoin. So with gold, you have supply increase, but you have demand destruction as people print rings and women will never give them back. So
I shared on the screen the definition from an article where Andreessen went against Warren Buffett and describing what the valuation of a BTC is. I think this is a good point for us to check that out. I agree with this definition of BTC and what it is.
It's a little complicated.
A value of a Bitcoin is not arbitrary. In fact, it's the opposite of arbitrary. It equals the value of a single slot in a finite-sized public cryptographic ledger through which value can move. The total Bitcoin ledger has value corresponding to the volume and velocity of transactions that will run through it in the future. By extension, each slot in the ledger has fractional value determined by the total number of slots. which in Bitcoin's case are limited to 11 million today and 21 million ever.
Right. So is it an analogy to finite inflation? Like, you know, you have a finite inflation, so you know as Bitcoin gets to its maximum amount printed, value has to increase. It's just like the value of real estate in LA. There's just no more houses. So it goes up.
The market cap of the ledger needs to be high enough to accommodate all the value that wants to pass through it in a given period of time. That's really important. The volume and velocity of value passing through is what determines the value. It's like a garden hose.
So here, let me tell you what the issue is with this, is that if you get a bigger and bigger user base, the value of Bitcoin inherently rises, right?
Correct. The further the adoption goes, the more people that put information through that blockchain is going to
literally... The problem is the velocity of the transactions puts pressure on Bitcoin prices down because there isn't a way to buy the supply of goods for your services in Bitcoin. So I have to then convert it back to a currency that I can use to buy my goods to create my services. So
but that's going
to
change more and more over time as people realize that maybe
it took us 100 years to develop the system that still sucks here. Okay? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that was the old days. Look how fast things are progressing on the internet today. YouTube came out of nowhere. Google Hangouts came out of nowhere.
That's true.
The internet definitely is speeding up everything, for sure.
I agree with that. And we cannot predict how long this will take to get right. But as you're learning, being early adapters, there's a lot of bumps in the road and some huge ones.
The Great Depression lasted 14 years.
So in tech years, that still might be four, you know?
I think 15 years is a good curve. In markets, that's a general cycle from cycle to cycle, 15 years. You look at the internet 15 years ago, you look at, you look forward 15 years from the introduction of Bitcoin, I think you'll see much the same adoption curve, that you saw the internet have. I don't think anybody could have imagined some of the platforms that exist on top of the internet 9, 10 years ago.
Yeah, so Ross, you actually brought up an interesting point. Like, you talked about how if demand for Bitcoin grows, but the problem is that you have to cash out, right? So the thing is, if you think about it, like, so Bitcoin is roughly 6 years old right now, and the thing is, in the last few years, Bitcoin, I think startup investment has exceeded at least 1 point some billion,
right?
And that was only recently, right? So first off, those things will take some time to actually develop and actually like come into being. And the thing is, if Bitcoin does become more and more popular, just by sheer supply and demand, other services should also come up that should accommodate for that. So if it does ever reach the point where it is a global force, then there should be more than enough services that will accept Bitcoin as is that you shouldn't have to cash out, if it does get to that point.
Yeah, but like,
the analogy now is that we're building, it's when the internet first came about, then, you know, there was all this kind of hype, a bit like what's going on with Bitcoin now, but people like Mark Andreessen, we're building out the infrastructure quietly, and that's kind of what's happening with Bitcoin. And once the infrastructure was there, you know, then you know, and all houses had broadband. This is when the internet really exploded.
Yeah.
Like, so let me tell you the other problem. You have to build out infrastructure with the right people, and that's the Mt. Gox problem. Because what happens is the only thing that keeps America afloat is trust. Okay, it says right on the dollar bill, you know, in God we trust, because that's all that backs our dollar, essentially. And the tax.
And then it says, Animus Fortis, Novus Ordo Seclorum, the grand undertaking of the New World Order. It also says that on there. Never forget that.
But I think when you think about it from Bitcoin, you have to be able to have players that people trust. And when you have the, you know, exchange go bust, you know, and money's gone, and now we're tracking it down. And then the federal guys are so corrupt, they steal the Bitcoins from the Bitcoin thieves. And then,
so
you
Ross,
know.
This is a really interesting point. So Flibber and I do hangouts called Whale Club, and we've invited just about every major exchange, Bitcoin exchange, including the regulated ones in the States. And there are two kind of camps. There are exchanges which want to be regulated and go down that path, and there are the exchanges that don't care. And so far, the exchanges that have done really well are the ones who engage in the minimal amount of AML, KYC, minimal to none. And what Max really tells me is that people have, you know, this meme that somehow consumer wants regulation, consumer feels protected by the government, this meme is either not true or it's dying out, because the successful exchanges are the ones located in the Bahamas, you know, in Singapore,
course,
and Hong Kong.
Of course, of course. I mean, honestly, if I wanted to hide money from somebody, it's so great. You know?
I wonder if it's not even so much the idea of hiding money. It's just that there's much less friction to use these exchanges.
It's a better user experience when you don't have to send 30 different copies of your passport because the first 29 they rejected because it wasn't clear enough.
Well, exactly. I can't even do an international wire. That's no debate.
Here's the other thing. Just about every exchange that's not in the United States is now refusing, United States customers. OKCoin, one of the biggest exchanges in the world, has actually cut off the entire United States.
Our laws are so strict. You don't understand.
Why do you keep saying our laws? It's a bunch of people that you've never met decided for you.
The laws that are in. Listen, I operate in the country I'm in, man.
They're not your laws. It's a bunch of people you've never met wrote down words and pieces of paper and said you have to obey these or they're going to hurt you.
Listen, these politicians are not going to hurt me. They're the easiest people.
If you don't obey their laws, they'll hurt you. That's what a law is.
They're the nicest people to me. You would be shocked.
As long as you obey.
I do pay.
If you don't obey, they'll toss you in a cage.
Of course I do whatever I want. What am I going to do? I don't do anything bad. What am I going to do? They even legalized pot now. I mean, what am I going to do?
Let's segue to the point.
Drink and drive. That's the only thing I avoid doing. But going back on point here. Okay, so you have this issue of I can't send money internationally because the laws are so strict against AML and everything else and the Patriot Act. Okay, and I don't like this. But the fact that it's so easy to use Bitcoin is wonderful, and it will not happen in this country.
Do you think the regulation can come into place, though, just like the Internet? There was many things that regulations that were at the time were not in place to accommodate when the Internet proliferation began, and the infrastructure kind of grew with it. You know, I think anonymity is, you know, Ace has told me it's not quite as anonymous as you think, and there is going to be ways to make Bitcoin fully traceable. I think, you know, the non-recourse aspect of Bitcoin is definitely a concern for a lot of people, that no transactions are final.
Well, I would argue that the blockchain creates a chain of everybody who had that coin, so it's actually completely traceable.
Yeah, that's another thing about it. It's actually not as anonymous as people think. So I actually want to touch upon
the public ledger.
Started off with that general fear, isn't it? Correct.
And this is the thing. So
that it was anonymous, but it really isn't. It's a going fear that it's totally anonymous, but it actually isn't. So they can develop systems to make it
worse
more traceable.
Than cash. So then, why wouldn't I just use cash anyways? Because if you can actually look through the blockchain, that's a piece of evidence that those governments can use very well.
Mm-hmm. Bitcoin is not anonymous because the United States Police Force, FBI, have had no problem in bringing dozens and dozens of people down who use Bitcoin.
Yes. Right, because you can trace the blockchain. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So a very interesting point, right? So about a month ago, the UK, Her Majesty's Treasury, actually released a national risk assessment of money laundering and terrorist financing. And I'll actually link you guys the doc itself. But basically, it's showing an image, shows that it ranks the most likely ways that terrorists would most likely use for money laundering. And if you look, digital currencies is one of the least risk exposing levels. And banks, accountancy service providers, and legal service providers, and money service businesses are one of the highest ways that a terrorist would actually use to launder money.
You just gave me a government document.
So yes, I did.
Flip it over, and that's the truth.
So it's interesting to see that they basically said that digital currency is actually not that big of a priority for terrorists, but they're kind of using the whole Paris and ISIS thing as a segue to make that to get over that regulatory hurdle and put regulations in place to try and actually stomp it out, as you said.
Yeah, Yeah, they're going to do it. They're going to do it. So unless you guys are ready to die.
I think this is taking, the conversation is taking a turn a bit like, you know, 2013, 2012. There are two clear sides to this, that certainly Bitcoin is very disruptive. It's now very clear to all governments, because just about every major government in the world has commented that Bitcoin actually is, you know, a major, you know, they see it as an emerging force, and they're looking at ways to, you know, to integrate it and to make use of it and to make use of the technology. And, you know, so the reception in from one side of is very, you know, accepting and like, how can we deal with this? They're starting to understand it's like the internet. This is something that won't go away.
Yeah, it's actually like, that's one of the key points though, right? Like, if you, like, they're trying to stop it, but the thing is, in the end, they can't. Like, even if they wanted to,
I think the premise that they're trying to stop it is wrong, because one side is very clearly looking at the integration. However, in any government, there's always opposing forces. And of course,
yeah, so what would you say to that?
There are the side and the side that resists change, and of course there's all the lobby as well for, you know, the incumbents in the industry. We've seen banks.
And exactly what you're saying, the good point you're making is that there is like Visa, there's IBM and, you know, IoT protocol. There is a lot of money coming in from large corporations into a place that, you know, Ross, you think is terminal.
What I was about to say is, here are some things I think that Bitcoin could do to make it have a better chance. Like, if you look at the history of the stock exchanges in America, it started off exactly like Bitcoin. Brokerage firms went bankrupt, you know, and like, people lost their money and they would like go stand outside of a bank or a brokerage firm trying to get their money. And what happened? The FDIC was formed and the Securities Act of 33 and 34. And what they did was they said, we have to have some sort of general protocol or some, you know, standard that some trusting body can create that level of trust that people can entrust having their savings in this, mm-hmm. knowing that it's not going to just disappear. And they must insure the deposits of the members of the exchange so that people will be comfortable with the fact that their money is being held by these people, essentially.
So I think the point Ross is trying to make is just basically that Bitcoin will be regulated. I think that's his
main. Oh, yeah, yeah, there's no way around that.
Mm-hmm. I think that's the
thing. You don't understand
how
Bitcoin
works. You're better off self-regulating.
Yeah, Bitcoin cannot be regulated. What can be regulated are the fiat entrance and exits to Bitcoin in certain jurisdictions. But you've got to understand, like, I remember a long time ago there was a conjecture that the fax machine was probably responsible for the fall of the USSR, because the fax machine was the first thing which allowed the free flow of information in a state that was controlling the information to maintain its existence. And the fax machine itself is a really good example of how technology, you know, the system has to adapt to the technology. In the very beginning, the United States Postal Service said that fax machines were under their jurisdiction, and that any fax had to be, even if you sent a fax from California to, you know, San Francisco, it would have to go to the post office, and the post office would then have to deliver it, because they considered it first-class mail. And if you sent a fax, then, you know, you were directly, you were breaking United States laws. You know, eventually, look what happened. Not only did the fax machine take over, you know, the fax machine then, you know, caused the innovation of other technology, you know, and look where we are today with instant communication. The postal service is a dying beast. Right, and so this is.
I think you should give the Chinese government a shot.
Let's give all governments a shot. We don't need a ruling class to tell us how to live our lives.
China's the toughest one. You can't use Twitter there. You can't use Facebook or Google there. How do they do that?
They all use VPNs, and they're still on Twitter and Facebook.
I know that for the most part, but really, you can't really use it there.
Yeah, and that's one more reason why that government's illegitimate too.
And
a bunch of people decided for everybody
all
else.
All the songs on iTunes. I mean, these people are going through song by song. Oh, sorry, that's too free sounding.
But why is it crazy when the Chinese government does that to those people, but not crazy when the U.S. government does it to the people in the U.S.? It's the same sort of thing.
The idiots in the office that are doing this. It's our fault. You got to take them responsibility for these idiots. It's
absolutely not. By that crazy logic, the Jews are the ones that round themselves up and sent them off to concentration camps, too.
People trust me, they come beg me for help. I'm having lunch with the head of the freaking Democratic Party in L.A. in like a week. He's taking me out to lunch. You know, it's like these
people... Oh, hang on a second, Ross. We're getting seriously off topic here. We're going on libertarian anarchistic debate. Hang on a second. Yeah, let's... I want to make a point here, Ross, because honestly, I've listened to all of you for like 20 minutes, and I've been desperate to make one point. The reason why I got into Bitcoin originally was about ownership. And being kind of like anti the state and fearful of the state taking control of my money and my assets, I was originally interested, I think many of the early adopters were interested in Bitcoin because it is possibly the only thing in this world that you can actually own that can't be taken off you. Your house can be taken off you, every money, everything you have can be taken off you, but your Bitcoin can never be taken off you. And I think that in itself is worth a lot.
What do you mean by that exactly?
That's a pretty cool point.
There's no
seizing of the Bitcoin that you have. Your Bitcoin is your own. There's no tax on it. It is literally your own once you own it.
Provided that it's not on an exchange. If you actually own, like, if you have your own wallet.
Right, don't you have to...
Let's qualify. Let's qualify this. So the technical question. Bitcoins are controlled by the private key. There are no Bitcoins, actually, right?
Right.
It's just, you know, have an entry on the ledger. And the protocol defines, you know, whoever owns the private key for your coins, you know, your inverted commas, can spend them. So the only way for, you know, the government to take your money off you would be for somehow to get your private keys.
Mm-hmm.
So if you secure your private keys properly, then there is nothing that can be done to take.
So what happens when you die?
If you die, then If the private keys are lost with you, you never gave it away.
There is real risk of you losing your coins, losing control to your coins. You can't go crying to mummy. You can't go crying to the FDIC. You know, it's...
So that's a way to take the coins off of you.
No.
Let me speak. So obviously there are ways to, you know...
Torture people. Torture them.
The $5 entry tax, yes. But for an inheritance, of course, you can have a system. There are ways to pass inheritance. In fact, there's a new opcode, a new thing being rolled out in the Bitcoin protocol, which should actually allow you to create an inheritance script. So you can define that, you know, after a certain point in future, someone else will be able to take, you know, to spend your coins. So it could be a lawyer plus, you know, someone from your family or whatever, you know, whatever, right?
You're going to have to put it in the wills.
But the difference here is that if you have money in the bank, you know, the government, the courts can force the bank's hand to take your money or your house.
Oh, yeah, in 2 minutes they can freeze your account.
But with Bitcoin, you know, the government can make a hand down an edict. The courts can, you know, make a judgment, but to enforce it. And I think that's really... It's the first time where there's true sovereignty. There's true monetary sovereignty.
Mm-hmm. I love that.
I think it's great.
Mm-hmm.
I think from what I'm seeing, you know, like, it's really nice to have met you. I think we trolled each other a bit on Twitter, but like, it's very clear that you're not hating on Bitcoin, but you're being realistic about. Bitcoin would become a big thing. And by big thing, we're talking, you know, national currency scale big thing.
Like, look at it this way. Like, I'm in the business of making money, okay? So I've been following Bitcoin because I know how to do exchanges, trading, all this stuff. And if I can exploit it and make money, good. So... I have friends who are some...
Can I jump in one thing, Ross, that I think is pertinent to that, and I think you'll enjoy as far as making money? So you were talking about how governments aren't going to like Bitcoin and this and that, but like lots of people in government like to make money too. And whichever country around the world adopts Bitcoin first stands to make a heck of a lot of money.
That's a great idea. So when Ukraine went down, I was tweeting that Ukraine should adopt Bitcoin and be the first country to adopt Bitcoin. That would be huge.
And whichever country is first stands to make a huge amount of money.
So that's one option.
Oh, yeah.
Option for Bitcoin to succeed is start your own country. Okay? Now, you could do that.
Go over too well.
Like, no, this is how the Bahamas and the Cayman Islands work. In the Caymans, it's all banks. It's just all banks. It's a country. It's not a country. Let's be real. It's a scam, you know?
And how can you say something like that? All countries are scams by that same logic.
In some ways, there's our scam and there's everybody else's scam. And the only difference is size.
Yeah. The U.S. has 300-something million participants. The Cayman Islands has maybe 100,000 participants.
So with Bitcoin, if you buy Bitcoins today and it is mass adapted across the world and the scarcity is 22 million coins and there's 6 billion people and 10% use them, okay, or even 2% use them, we would all be super rich, okay? So don't tell me you're doing this just for the fact that you hate governments or something. You want to make money, and that's totally fine, because I'm American. In America, that's the American way, okay? So when
what
you
does
th-
that even mean?
I think everybody
think other
world
people in other countries
money,
can't have the same
No, but see, in America, when you make a lot of money,
Japan, I like to be destitute.
You control the politicians, and then everything kind of works out, and the lawyers. So our system is easy to work. The issue is that, so how do I get that to work when all these people really, you know, Visa's into it? You think they want to lose their 3% on billions and trillions of transactions? They'll come to your house and kill you.
No, but they want to cut costs and remittance, and that's going to expand their margins. That's what they do want to do.
It's a fallacy.
They don't want margin compression. That's the Square thing. You know, like Square's still 3%. They make 3%. That is such a scam. It is such a scam.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And if they can get their hands on blockchain technology, they can keep that 3% in place and expand their margins in the back end.
So who started Visa and who owned Visa? The banks, okay? And who pays all the politicians? The banks. And who screws over this country more than any other institutions in the world? The banks.
Correct. And they've got Congress in their pockets.
You in jail for Bitcoin and regulate you out of business? The banks.
But you do have a lot of banks that are looking at the integration of blockchain in their business models.
Because you keep the enemy close, okay?
Absolutely. But so what's to say that they're still not going to help proliferate the blockchain technology themselves because they see the benefit in it?
They are as innovative as the kitchen sink at a bank, okay? I can't get a bank to loan to somebody, a person they can't even do.
There's a bit of a fallacy here that banks are adopting Bitcoin or that Visa is adopting Bitcoin.
Not adopting Bitcoin, but some of the technologies from it, you know, blockchain technology, they are exploring that.
Well, exactly. But, I mean, so, Ross, I'm a Bitcoin developer. I'm also a trader. I came to Bitcoin actually because of the money, you know.
Which is fine. Trust me.
Right? So, and, you know, so I get that. But this whole thing of people exploring so-called blockchain technology is not necessarily going to help Bitcoin's case at all. I think it's a very misguided. I mean, technically speaking, it's a maybe off topic for this chat, but you know, blockchain technology is a bit of a scam, you know, because you can't actually separate Bitcoin. At least a decentralized financial system that Bitcoin is. You can't separate the Bitcoin and the blockchain. It is one and the same thing.
So what does there need to be a blockchain based only in the Bitcoin world? Couldn't each sovereign nation come up with their own blockchain?
Well, the thing is, it wouldn't be just as effective. It would be more of a kind of like a database that they're kind of just keeping track of.
Shapeshift.io will be really happy if that happens.
So the issue is that what Bitcoin offers is actually decentralized peer-to-peer money without a third-party intermediary. What the banks are looking at is, you know, they like this idea of how Bitcoin operates, but of course they want control over it. They want to be able to control the participants. They want to be able to control who can sign the ledger. And all they're doing is creating, you know, a fancy database system.
I agree. And can I just ask something, Andrew? I also want to say that not only is Bitcoin the decentralized, stateless currency,
that little point that you went out,
but it is also backed by the most secure supercomputing network on the planet. And that kind of security behind the Bitcoin, you know, network is what's going to keep it as number one. So when they're creating these altcoins for their private banks and private ledgers, they just will not have the security that Bitcoin will have.
Mm-hmm. So that's actually a very...
That exists make it harder for Bitcoin to survive. See, what there can't be all these coins. It's got to just be Bitcoin, you know?
Bitcoin is going to be the dominant coin. I mean, like what he's saying, you're never going to have the security and hashing power you have on any other network like you have on
that's
Bitcoin.
Right. And you've already invested so much.
But a permissioned ledger doesn't... Right, what's the whole mining process? The whole mining process is a very, very inefficient trade-off in order to have decentralization.
You have to offer an incentive for someone to basically...
Well, so the idea of mining is that people have to expend real-world resources, and it's distributed, so everyone has to remain honest, you know, because you have to follow what the majority is going to do, you know. So, but a permissioned ledger, you don't need any of that. It's just a database, and you know, if you say there's a permissioned ledger being released soon called Liquid for Bitcoin exchanges, a company called Blockstream is releasing this, and that is a permissioned ledger. So you have all of the exchanges who, you know, so OKCoin, Bitfinex, you know, Coinbase, etc., will all subscribe to this. And I think out of, they need 5 signatures from the different exchanges to sign the block. And so in that system, you know, there is no consensus that need, you know, global consensus they need to come to. You know, it's just 5 exchanges are going to sign the block. So there's no need for mining, you know, there's no need for wasting of power, there's no need for, you know, huge block intervals. It's just, you can just do it because you have control of effectively a central system. And that's the kind of thing that Visa, you know, and the banks are going to be looking at. You know, that's the model they want. So, I mean, Bitcoin really is orthogonal. It's a completely different thing to what the banks are trying to achieve. However, that technology is very smart, you know, and it's very efficient for the things the banks want to do.
Here's a thought, though, to what you're saying, because you're talking about variations of the blockchain and efficiencies of it. You know, like right now, the way I look at the world is all money is digital. Okay, so like on my computer right now, I actually have $400 million, okay? So I can move that into any asset I want anywhere. And there's some...
Buy Bitcoin. Stick it all into Bitcoin now.
I mean, like, 1 minute to load up.
I know. But see, I couldn't even do that. I couldn't even do that. There would be no way for me to buy that many Bitcoins easily.
Exactly. Remember what I told you? The velocity of value through the ledger. Why don't you throw some velocity through that ledger?
Well, that's what you do with penny stocks. You know, that's the idea, right? So when you control a certain amount of money, you can move markets, you know? And I can move stocks easily, now, easily, because the volatility is so easy now. I mean, it's crazy. So like, it's all digital. So if I have a client in Europe and she transfers euros in and we transfer it to dollars, then I transfer it to stocks, they go up in value, then I transfer it back to money, then I transfer it back to her account in her bank, and then she goes and uses her debit card and buys food. It's all digital the whole way, okay? And then the food place pays their vendors digitally and whatever. So there already is a digital global monetary system, and Bitcoin's an alternative system, and what you're trying to do is build an alternative system that took like 100 years to build. And so in tech years, maybe that can happen in 10 years, okay? And now you've built this whole system that puts pressure on this system, the old system, for fees and profits and things like that. You know, is it really worth it? And that's
absolutely
the question.
Russ, I mean, let's have an example of books, for example. I mean, let's just say, how long did it take for people to begin writing books and printing books and, you know, publishing books and bookstores, and then we get digital books? How quickly did digital books completely destroy the previous market?
I read books.
Yeah, I do too, and there'll be people that will still be spending cash.
This market, and Airbnb has destroyed my old neighborhood, and
Uber.
I'm tired of this destruction.
But I mean,
digital destruction is a nightmare.
Things, right?
It's a nightmare. I hate every one of these. I use all the services and I love them personally, but I hate them. They're disruptive to everything that I've used to like. Now you want to totally fuck up the monetary system, and these guys don't want you to.
We don't want to. We're already doing it.
I know you are, and I love it. I love it, actually, to be honest. I just
of
think
course it's you really love it. We all love it.
Right, but it's just a really, really
if
tough
you didn't
task.
Love it, you guys are like it.
You like love pain or something, you know?
Yeah. I think blockchain and Bitcoin presents a platform that you can make an analogy to, like iOS did. You know, when iOS protocol came out on iOS operating system came out on the iPhone, no one could dream of the applications market that would actually form on top of it when they first saw it. Blockchain creates an analogy to that here in the remittance market and in smart contracts, or at least the possibility of smart contracts and managing information. I think, you know, 4 or 5 years out, you're going to see, you know, applications on top of this technology that no one could have dreamed of today.
Okay, let's say you convince me. I want to put $100,000 into Bitcoins right now, okay?
Uh-huh.
How do I know? You say that it's mine, okay? How do I really know that when all I have is a digital key?
Oh, Ross, you know that money is yours more than you know any other money or anything else in the world is yours.
And you're convincing. I would believe you.
Remember what Drax said exactly about the private keys. Like, that's a code that there's no one stealing that from you. Okay, if you protect that key, you own that coin, that part
the
of the ledger.
The technology that secures Bitcoin, the digital signature tech. So here's another misnomer about Bitcoin. Bitcoin is brilliant. But Bitcoin isn't actually, like, the technology that runs Bitcoin is nothing new. Some of it is decades old. What's brilliant about Bitcoin is how the technologies were put together in an incentive system to create this decentralized peer-to-peer money.
Yeah.
Right? So digital public key cryptography and digital signatures, the technology that Bitcoin uses, it's rock solid. And if there's a problem with that technology, trust me, the world has bigger problems, right?
Mm. Because the internet is going to be
everything wrong. Will fall down.
So anything that deals with encryption would be obsolete if there's a problem with Bitcoin in that term.
Quantum computer stands to be the only real headache for Bitcoin going
forward. Right, okay, but see, like, so I am a financial institution. I have one, okay? So I'm the face of my institution. And clients come in, like this lady came in and she gave us $1.5 million last night, right? So she has to trust me, because even though I'm opening up an account in our system with all these protections and SIPC and FDIC and everything else, in the end, they're still trusting me. And that's one of the things that Bitcoin really needs. Is
no,
somebody
the fact that Bitcoin doesn't that. Need that that makes it so much
but,
better.
But
you don't
I
have
don't
to
know. Who do I trust? Who do I
you
trust?
You don't have to. That's the
you don't have to trust anybody.
Trust somebody.
You don't have to trust anybody.
I gotta trust my calculator?
How you were talking about Bitcoin illustrates your lack of understanding of, like, fundamental,
no,
like,
no,
what
human
Bitcoin
behavior.
Is.
No.
Let me bring up a very good point.
Hang on, Flipper. That's
all right. So what Ross is kind of saying is actually it reflects.
I was born, there wasn't computers.
Mm-hmm. So a lot of people will have to do the whole trust aspect, and they have a need
for it. I trust this?
Yeah, so one thing that Ross is saying, it's kind of like a generational thing, right? So people,
so
people his age and like the around him are used to a certain way of things, and they want to see that.
Yeah,
we get stolen from you. Yeah, but the thing is, imagine like what we're seeing right now, like you know how what's it called? Like there was a YouTube video of a baby, right? And basically, it was on an iPad, reading like looking at different pictures. And then his mom gave him a book or a magazine, and the baby takes the magazine and tries swiping it instead of turning the pages.
I have that baby. Mm-hmm.
So the thing is,
and I'm not seeing him right now to be doing this.
So in that same aspect, like people in your generation might have that need for trust, but the whole newer and younger generations don't have that necessary need.
I don't necessarily agree with that.
No, I don't agree with that either.
Because I work with a lot of young clients. A lot of young people are clients of mine.
I'm thinking, what are you saying, like 15 years forward, the people that are kids that grow up with this technology all around them and never know of the way it used to be, it'll be second nature and easier to trust for an entire generation. And that's why I said the adoption curve of 15 years from the internet makes sense. You know, if you think 15 years out from now, 5-year-olds, my son who's 9 years old, this will be second nature to him, and it seems perfectly normal to talk about Bitcoin. You know, he has his own little MT4 full of bits in it, and it makes total sense in the world to him, and he doesn't understand anything about the world you're talking about. When he's 25 years old, digital money and having a system like this and, you know, credits like Star Trek are going to be completely second nature to him. Mm-hmm. And
I can't argue this because, you know, I'm kind of young at heart, and now I'm older, so I live in this weird world of, you know, not accepting my age, really. I don't really relate to people my age. What you're saying is true, 100%. But some things never change too, okay? And I think, like, when it comes to money, some things never change. And you know, people, especially when you have a certain amount of money, are pretty protective of it. So I see people who have Bitcoin wallets with a few $1,000. But that's why I like using the example of $100,000 or $1 million or $10 million. Would you really trust if you had $10 million?
Yes, absolutely.
Really?
Absolutely.
Way more than a bank.
Absolutely, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Because I would never dream of keeping $10 million worth of value in a bank. I would never try to keep it in my
Bitcoin wallet. I want to hear Roger's point.
Do you trust your broker-dealer,
I mean, I can't argue with you. I mean, it's a perception.
But let's hear Roger. Let's hear off Roger on this. Come on.
Yeah, if hypothetically speaking, if I had $10 million, I would. And if I had to rank where I would keep it, it would be Bitcoin.
I know you
under
would.
My mattress, and then in the bank.
Listen, I have some gold. I mean, I have some gold because.
Okay.
Wait. You know, the same reason. The same reason.
Do you trust your broker dealer, Ross?
Only so much, and it's my fiduciary. It's my fiduciary responsibility to make sure that though they're doing their job. And let me tell you, I've gone there. I'm friends with the president. I've walked through the floor. I mean, it's. I've worked.
You have politicians and laws. Why do you have to check on that?
Because it's my job. That's I'm the financial institution.
So what are the politicians and the laws for?
They're regulators. They're regulators.
This is an example of the trust, right?
Remember, the people trust me with $400 million. Me.
I would much rather trust Bitcoin than any human. Because with Bitcoin, we're not trusting.
And I'll kill you if you try to take it, too.
Okay, listen, Russ. With Bitcoin, when you put your money into Bitcoin, you're not trusting another human. You're not trusting somebody the government isn't going to issue a court order to seize your funds. Hang on a second, Russ. Let me just finish my point here. So when I put my money into Bitcoin, it is secured by cryptography, and that's it. So basically, it is secure. And if there was at some point the algorithm that secures Bitcoin was to be broken, basically the whole of Bitcoin would collapse instantly. And I'm pretty sure at that point there would be an instantaneous kind of like point that would say, oh look, that's where the cryptography that secures the whole Bitcoin network faltered. We will, you know, re-upgrade the system, and we will restart. We'll get Ask Miners to restart from that point forward using the new algorithm. Like, I mean, as in case that would be is.
Stop on the statement you just made. Okay, would you say that there is a zero, absolute zero probability that scenario could ever happen?
I would never say zero probability because I'm not an idiot.
So, if in 2008. The entire global financial system almost failed, then Bitcoin should have to accept that at some point the entire algorithm could fail.
But it's
and what would happen? And what would be the procedures in this decentralized world to fix it?
I think Drak is best to answer this.
The Bitcoin Foundation would have to basically patch the code, right? Explain that for us, Drak.
Well, in 2013, there was a glitch which caused, you know, a hard fork in the network, and it was serious, where the miners... Someone turn off their mic.
Is that Flivers' mic? Whose mic's echoing?
Yeah, so... There was an unintentional hard fork where the miners and the rest of the network split, And at that point, the developers, you know, everyone got together. The developers started contacting the miners. They worked out what the bug was, and very, very quickly they released a patch which fixed it. And if something like that catastrophic happened, then it wouldn't be good temporarily for the price, but you can be rest assured it would be fixed. However, if the cryptography, let's say if all cryptography failed, like tomorrow, such that all cryptography could be broken, the least of our worries would be Bitcoin, because everything would be screwed. Your banks would be screwed, internet commerce would be screwed, you know, I mean, it would be catastrophic. And so that's why there's quite a decent assurance about the Bitcoin system.
Yeah, but I think the, you know, you say quite a bit insurance, the Black Swan event has, like, we have disaster recovery procedures that we have to have in writing. And I sit around scared, like, what happens if I turn on the computer and it just says zero? I call my broker-dealer and be like, where's the money? And they're like, oh, it just says zero on our computers, too. What would happen? You know, like, that's
I think the odds of that happening with traditional banks is
it's
way,
not that
way
odds.
Higher than with Bitcoin.
But we have
but
a
what is the recourse? What
we
is
have
recourse
a
if we
program
do have
that we have to run
okay.
through as if it happened.
Let me say the process of recourse. So say that Bitcoin has like an error like that that needs to be corrected. Then what is the process like globally with this system? Like
who would be in charge
protocol?
Of it?
What happens at that point?
You would have to
reach consent. That question.
Has to be a majority.
I can tell you right now, if it happened, then Bitcoin core developers would be the ones fixing it. Because
so I guess, you know, from his standpoint, like, you know, you have a go-to agency you can contact when, you know, if your money's missing in the bank, you can talk to FDIC. Like, who contacts the core developers and say, we have a crisis, the entire monetary system is frozen? Like, who does that?
I mean,
well, that's one, where I guess, you know, Ross is talking.
One of, like, it's one of those, I mean, like, so this is different, okay? I mean, this is one of the things where it would become apparent and alarm bells would be going off everywhere. You know, there are many, many people watching the Bitcoin network, you know, every transaction, every block, looking for issues. And there's probably more eyes on that than there are on, you know, many, many computer systems and networks.
I think from where we come from, he's kind of thinking in terms of, is there a centralized authority that in the case of crisis that we all can basically say, you guys must solve this.
In 2013, what Drak mentioned before, there was a split in the blockchain, and there were people on mining two separate blockchains and people using two separate blockchains, and that's a huge problem for Bitcoin, and it was amazing. Within just a couple of hours, everybody coordinating from all over the world, Bitcoin miners and core developers, they were all getting together on Skype and Google Hangouts and coordinating exactly what to do. And within just a couple of hours, they had all the miners in China and around the world pointing to the correct blockchain, which at the time was the shorter one, and they had enough hashing power diverted to that one to where it was able to overtake the other one that was deemed to be the incorrect blockchain. And it was amazing how all these, you know, thousands or maybe tens of thousands of people around the world were able to come together and coordinate in just a matter of hours to rectify the problem.
Well, now Bitcoin's exponentially larger, so
yeah.
I mean,
I think can I
people
just
have even more incentive to correcting the problem.
Exactly. As Roger said, the more the more people that come into the network, the more money is invested, the more vested interest there is in quicking any issues that arise as fast as possible.
The more people fighting over the solution.
It's kind of like it's, you know, you get the best ideas from mixing a synergy in the system because everyone is kind of pointed in the same way that, you know.
Well, that's what they said about democracy, but your friend hates it, you know.
Okay, Ross, I can address that question. So, one of the core principles written in the Satoshi white paper about Bitcoin is that Bitcoin is hard to change. So the idea initially was that, you know.
So who is this guy? I mean,
nobody knows. Okay.
What the fuck is that? that's the hardest thing for me. Okay. Okay. This story is so hard for me. I live in Hollywood. Okay. It's ridiculous. The Satoshi guy. I mean, and then some guys like they're beating down some old guy, Japanese guy's house. You know.
I know.
I mean, you guys have got to stop this. It's about trust. It's about trust.
So the interesting
it's probably, point... Satoshi's probably a pseudonym for NSA and MIT's project back in 1996.
I know. I mean, who knows? It might be the government. Maybe they're just like, I don't know. I came up with a couple of movie lines for this one.
So Bitcoin is intentionally hard to change unless there is overwhelming consensus, you know, and by consensus I mean consensus of everyone, technical community, users, etc., etc. And we've actually seen this recently. You know, there's a bit of an internal dispute going on about what part of the protocol design. Some people want to change it one way, and you know, others want to change it another way. And the, you know, this is something that's actually raged for many years and hasn't changed. You know, it's looking like there will be some adjustment made soon, but it's very, very clear that you can't just, you know, make a change to the Bitcoin protocol. In 2013, when there was a crisis, everyone got together and the solution was obvious, what needed to be done. You know, and so I think this is a really good like analogy. If there's a crisis and something kind of brain dead obvious that needs to be done, you know, because the network is failing now, then it will be fixed now.
Yeah, you should run through. You should be running through programs now to see what would happen.
Yeah, they do.
Well, yeah, they do run similar tests. But I think let's just have a small recap here. Who the hell has got that feedback? Okay, it's just stopped. Yeah, so I think we've discussed that. You know, that Bitcoin is stateless, decentralized, it is, you know, finite, that if there's a problem, there's the bigger it is, the more vested interest there is to fix it as quick as possible. I think what I want to come back to here, Ross, is that you actually said Bitcoin is like digital gold. And I would argue that Bitcoin is better than gold in every single aspect of what gold does, apart from make rings and earrings.
Of course.
That's why we don't use gold. What about moving gold to the blockchain?
As the storehouse of value to back Bitcoin.
You don't need to do that.
It could be taken from you.
Yeah. Yeah, the gold needs to be accounted for, it needs to be audited. With Bitcoin, that can be done automatically.
I agree. It's more just, okay, so this is the last issue I think we discussed, and then I have to go see my kid. The issue is this, okay? To build trust, you have to have some level of price stability. When you look at a chart of the dollar over the long term, it's just like this, right? And so with Bitcoin, one of the things that hurts you are the traders themselves. Okay? So if Bitcoin, if you got rid of the whole Satoshi bullshit and you just said, hey, you know what? Bitcoin's fixed at 500. Okay? Now, obviously, you're not going to make money on the way up and you got to get rid of that whole thing. But people would know how prices work. I know. I'm just saying theoretically. But people would know that if they accepted Bitcoins for their goods and services, by holding them, they wouldn't have any fear that the change would be so great that the goods I need to buy to replenish my services, that price doesn't change too bad. That's
the
why
price of Bitcoin is already
Ross, Ross has basically one
Bitcoin.
All right, so
I'm saying too much volatility creates instability in using it as a common.
We need other financial products like you know, futures hedging and whatnot. I mean,
I can actually address this point pretty well, I think. So the thing is, he's basically saying that the volatility problem, right?
Right.
Yes. So think of it like this: let's say you have a small cup of water, and if you drop a golf ball into it, it'll make a huge splash and water will go everywhere. Now, if you drop a golf ball into the ocean, it'll have less of an impact, right? So that's kind of the whole problem with Bitcoin currently. Because the Bitcoin market cap is relatively small, we're experiencing these huge fluctuations in volatility. But if it were to ever reach a point of global adoption, then the market cap would be large enough that the volatility would be mitigated to an extent.
Absolutely.
But it's like the cart before the horse. You got to get there, and if people don't adopt it, then it doesn't get there.
Every market can rise through liquid, though. Every market has to have a buildup of liquidity, and this is just part of the adoption curve.
Yeah, there's no market that forms immediately liquid and perfect off the bat.
This is pretty much obvious.
That's not the debate. The debate isn't that it's okay or not. The debate is that if people don't adopt it,
but the volatility
then you can't get to that level
over time.
Russell, yeah, exactly. We're talking about a currency that has formed from nothing in just a few years. To expect it to be able to be super liquid to absorb, you know, vast amounts of money.
I'm not saying it should be, but it's not going to be if people don't adopt it.
Go ahead, Roger.
Adopt it.
I've been involved in Bitcoin long enough where I'm sitting in my living room here in Tokyo. If I look out my window to the left here, there were buildings right there that had a value much higher than the entire market cap of Bitcoin. I remember when the entire market cap of all the Bitcoins in existence in the entire world was less than $100 million, right? There's plenty of buildings around.
Right, and it's like, I think, $7 billion, right?
It's about three and a half now.
So it's like the value of Square, you know? It's
today,
like,
but my point is that just a few years ago, the value of all the Bitcoins in the world was less than $100 million.
Well, I know that.
Just a couple of years.
The more companies that stack on top of it,
if we're all going to get rich on Bitcoin, we got to convince other people to use it. And if it's moving all over the place, they're not going to use it.
Hey,
that's
Ross,
what I'm saying.
Ross, before you go and see your kid, I got one last point to leave you with, right? Because you said, you know, look, I want to accept Bitcoin. I'd rather be paid in Bitcoin for everything. And the reason is because when the government wants your money right now, they will ask you to give it them, and if they don't, yeah, they're going to come and they're going to take it off you or put you in jail, whatever, right? So now with Bitcoin, when the Bitcoin transaction, when they ask for your money, they can't come and forcibly take it off you. They have to ask for it very nicely, and you don't even have to give it them if you don't want to.
You've never been waterboarded.
Yeah, but I mean, I can't imagine anybody supporting a nation state that's going to waterboard somebody for tax money. So basically what it means is like the whole system of how a government goes about collecting revenue is going to have to change. And the reason why no country has done it so far is because the first country that does do it is going to have to think of a whole new solution of getting some kind of tax money, you know, to finance, you know, their little other stuff. It's a whole other debate.
You should be the Bitcoin Jesus. You should be the guy who dies for Bitcoin. Somebody has to die to prove the point, so there'll be such an uprising of support that it'll survive and prosper.
We already have the Bitcoin Jesus right here with us now.
I think for this to work, and the friends I have in Bitcoin, they're proselytizers. They're trying to spread Bitcoin around the world so it's mass adopted. And that is the goal of Bitcoin. So you need better PR, but you're not centralized, so you don't have a PR agency. Okay?
That's true.
And then two, you've got to have somebody that can be this face of trust, even if it's decentralized. The tech spokesperson, the Bitcoin Jesus, it's got to be a guy like you who tells the story right and is trustful looking, and doesn't steal the money
He doesn't have the ability to steal the money. So go watch some Andreas Antonopoulos videos on YouTube.
You've got to create exchange, some market makers in the Bitcoin exchange. What we had is called specialists. And when we had specialists on the New York Stock Exchange, the market was better than it is today. Because now the volatility is a nightmare. And more people are scared.
Blockchain could put a halt to HFT if the NASDAQ's running pilot programs. And if you had a blockchain-based stock market, HFT would die on arrival.
Well, right, but you know they want HFT because they make money off of it. But the issue is, if you had firms that would just buy or sell Bitcoin in opposite of its movement price to slow it down, that's what specialists do, you could create more stability on your own. So exchanges should have to make markets in it, not just trade other people's coins.
No, well, I mean, here at Whale Club TeamSpeak, you know, we do talk about the market makers that, you know, are making markets on all the exchanges all the time. So, I mean,
But you're not necessarily blunting volatility.
Mm-hmm. No, but they are providing liquidity, so...
And I think it does blunt the volatility as well. It would be more volatile without these traders.
There are services coming about now, which they are centralized services, so, I mean, kind of from the pure point of view of controlling your key, then it's not pure Bitcoin, but there are services now which will hedge the value of Bitcoin, so you can store your Bitcoin with them and keep it fixed to a dollar value.
Derivatives coming to the market, there are derivatives coming into this marketplace, and as the market landscape matures, I mean, Gemini just got going, Barry Silbert's fund is not really that liquid, but when we have more derivatives, you're going to find the market stabilizes a great deal more once we have options activity tied to it. The market just needs a chance to mature, and you know, I think it's along the curve of adoption that that's going to happen. And like Ace said, this isn't really slowing down. You know, the large companies that we see coming in, if you look at like the history of Bitcoin here, you can clearly see like the different eras of Bitcoins, you know, waves. And this is the 2013 time period they talked about, and before the ultimate Mt. Gox, you know, calamity. But capital is not going anywhere else. I mean, IoT and smart contracts are going to be the future of where that technology is really exploited. And Goldman Sachs, you know, made a very good point that the value in Bitcoin was the blockchain, and that they made that point from last year. And I still think that many of the corporations out there that see that technology is cost-cutting and beneficial are exploring it and putting money towards it. And if that that Andreessen quote on what valuation of a BTC is the velocity of value forced to the ledger, the more companies that put their hands on this are going to raise the price of BTC, incentivize the network for greater security, and be like a feedback loop going forward as it stabilizes and, you know, evolves and along the curve of adoption.
Now, the last thing I think that could help adoption is going where Bitcoin is most effective, where governments have failed. And if you could get people like missionaries to go to all these countries like Argentina and get users there to understand it where there's failed states, where it's really a huge advantage. Bitcoin actually a huge advantage, right? I mean,
Africa and countries like that are unbanked. There's a huge opportunity there.
I've been told that Kenya is where Bitcoin's been most adopted. I don't know if that's true. I've been told that.
No, I mean, I know an example of with somebody that was employing young girls in Afghanistan to write, you know, documents, and they were having trouble sending them the dollars, so they actually ended up sending them the Bitcoin.
Exactly. But yeah, if you could get people in India to use Bitcoin, you're done. You're done. You see what I'm saying? Because there's a billion of them.
I think that, you know, mobile technology and the unbanked is that's the unforeseen, like, real, you know, market is the unbanked.
And go show them how to do this, you know?
Have you been following the developments with, like, Coinbase and, you know, NASDAQ invested in Coinbase?
Yeah, a little bit.
You know, so, I mean, from your perspective, I mean, I actually thoroughly understand and sympathize with, you know, the situation you're in dealing with other people's money and the regulation that you're subjected to. And, I mean, I think it is good that there are exchanges which are being so-called regulated and giving some sort of confidence for that corner of the market, you know. I mean, And I think for you, that might be the first place to kind of explore. You know, talk to these guys. Reach out to the likes of Coinbase and I think ItBit. I mean, they're also another one, Gemini. You know, speak to these guys and from their perspective of dealing with the U.S. government, because that's the world you're dealing in, you know. I mean, many of us are different. We're kind of like... Pardon?
Isn't Coinbase a Morgan Stanley venture or initiative from somebody in Morgan Stanley? Coinsetter is a gentleman from J.P. Morgan. Coinbase is a gentleman from Morgan Stanley. Clearly those guys would not be in here if they thought it was going to be made illegal tomorrow.
No, I don't think it's going to be illegal. It's just they say, it's like DraftKings. You know, one day you're $1 billion, and the next day you're done. You know, it's how you do it and is so important. Like, for example, getting politicians on your side. You know,
I think it's positive that if you've got people like the NASDAQ investing in Coinbase, then it's fair to assume that the money lobby, the money lobby is there for the
government. They don't want to miss out. They don't want to miss out on anything. They don't want to miss anything. You could be
IBM dabbling in the space. If you Visa to see Microsoft, to see Dell, to see Overstock, to see the kind of corporations that are venturing into this space, they all have the power of the lobby. And the only reason they'd be here, you know, Google Ventures is involved in Ripple. Those guys are the guys who buy the politicians and make the laws. And for me to see that those corporations at the highest end of the curve are, you know, invested in researching Bitcoin technology, they're very much invested in buying somebody's campaign contributions and making him the guy who gets that vote.
I think you're right, and I think Bitcoin has a future. I'm not telling you guys to quit your jobs and what you're doing.
No, not at all.
I'm saying that in America, there are certain issues you're going to deal with no matter what, whether you want to care about what I say or not. In Europe, you're going to deal with those. In China, they're going to ban you, okay? But there are many places in the world where this could be very successful and grow, and if you focus on the issues that I've brought up, trust, volatility, usability, you know, how it's perceived. You know, you're always going to have bad actors, but where are the good actors? You know, who are the good actors? You know, and how you present that to a big marketplace, you have the opportunity. But I think we're what I try to get across to you guys is, A, you're fighting some guys who really don't want this, and that's very difficult. Not impossible, but difficult. And usually there's a martyr, okay? And B, the biggest market in the world that I trade in is still fucked up, okay? And so it's really hard to do this, right? And you're going to have a big failure, so you might as well figure out now how to fix that, so that people have faith in your system. And if you're able to do that, we'll all get rich and I'll buy some Bitcoins and ride the wave.
Cool. Well, Ross, start getting some of that client money, that woman who came with the 1.5 mil, just tell her to stick 5% into BTC, good risk reward.
Every time, okay?
Go on.
It's got to be conservative and don't lose my fucking money, okay? you know.
We're going to start wrapping this up, guys, but yeah, this has been a great conversation, man, because at the end of the day, there's just not enough understanding about what Bitcoin is, what the future of it holds, where we are in the adoption curve, and what really is coming at us going forward. And to have someone like yourself and Roger come from both sides of the aisle to sit here and discuss with us, you know, what basically both of you do understand at this point in time is hugely beneficial to Bitcoin's marketplace as a whole, because there needs to be more awareness brought to this technology and what it can do, where it is, and what the possibilities are around it. That's the real reason we're having this crypto roundtable, so that we can bring this to the marketplace that does want to know what you think and how hard it is to get through the regulatory hurdles to get us to Main Street. Mm-hmm. That's what's not understood from this side of the table with a lot of the enthusiasts, but you have a lot of brilliant people on this side of the fence, you know, like the panel that you have here tonight, that understand the utility of this technology and what it can do. And these are the guys who are going to change the world, the young people that I see in this market. I'm 37 years old. I'm a techno dinosaur. But I've met, like, the most insanely genius people in this marketplace, and many of them you have here in the panel tonight, that are going to be at the forefront of pushing this with the kind of like zeal that's going to get it to the next step. So I'm very, you know, excited to be involved in cryptographic markets and learning about it along with yourself. I mean, you and I are from the same time period, Ross, and for me this is like craziness, you know. I had a Pong machine when I was a kid, so this is kind of awesome to be part of.
Ross, sorry to interrupt you, Ross, I would like to say, you know, I part run a Bitcoin trading TeamSpeak server where we do a lot of voice chatting. You're more than welcome to come on there, Whale Club TeamSpeak. We would love you to come on, and we'll talk you to death for hours, I'm sure.
That's a great plan.
I have to say, I'll tell you, the reason I did this is I think that you guys are very, very smart, and I think you're doing a great thing. I really do. Being entrepreneurial and taking risks and trying to change things from the shitty way it is, I think is great. You know, and that's why I'm on here, is to help you, not fight you. You know what I mean? And I think you guys realize that.
I appreciate your time. Absolutely.
My skepticism is just going to be what it is. But
Ross, have you actually ever used Bitcoin before?
For what?
For anything. Do you own any Bitcoin at all?
No, I haven't.
I think so. Today's a day where Ross gets some wallet.
I'm going to send you Bitcoin over Google Hangouts from Tokyo to wherever you are. So.
No,
you have your phone handy, Ross? You ready for some free money?
I can't take your money. I can't take it. It's illegal.
It's illegal.
I'm all against that, even.
Bitcoin doesn't care.
good point.
They do come knocking on my door, the SEC. God willing, they don't, ever. But, you know, then I got to deal with them. But, but I think you guys, and at least the other people that I know involved with Bitcoin and blockchain are some of the smartest people out there right now. So I think that's your best chance of success. And I do have to say that I really enjoy this, being able to be on a show. You know, this is the future of entertainment, actually, as well as maybe the future of TV, not just the future of money. But I do want to be involved in continuing this. And thank you guys again for your time as well.
It was great having you as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've been taking time to come down and make a conversation for everybody to learn a lot more. You know, in the future, we plan to do more of this as things evolve in the marketplace. And I would definitely like in the future if I could definitely have both of you gentlemen back.
But we should definitely do this show again, and we'll get the marketing on it right, and we should do this again. I just think we should do it again.
Absolutely.
I've been more than happy to come back. Not the last. And Flipper, thank you for joining us. BTC Drac, Ace, you know, Ross and Roger, it's been definitely a pleasure to have you guys have this conversation. So I definitely look forward to doing it again. Ross, any closing comments? Roger, any closing comments you want to make?
Yeah, I think the reason Ross isn't a Bitcoin believer yet is because he hasn't tried it himself. Once he sees how amazing it is and how I could literally hold up my phone and I could send Bitcoin right from my phone, right through Google Hangout, right into Ross's phone in his living room in Hollywood, and he didn't have to give his name, he didn't have to give his email, he didn't have to give his tax ID number, and there's nothing anyone anywhere in the entire world can do to block that payment, he's going to be, oh my God, this is going to change the entire world. Why didn't I get involved full-time sooner? So after the show, give it a try. Install a Bitcoin wallet, Ross, and see.
All right,
I might try it. I also like Apple Pay, too.
Apple Pay.
Nearfield Communications yesterday, my friend. But I'm going to send you some link to get a wallet, and maybe we'll do a live Bitcoin tip for Ross and bring him into the era of Bitcoin and the blockchain on the next show.
There you go, Roger. Roger, you can send me some money if you want.
Ross can see how amazing it is. So there, I've scanned it. Here you go. So
Flipper is a quick study. Good move, Flipper.
I just sent you 400 yen.
Okay.
So watch yen, his phone. His phone should refresh. So just sent
if my
mine.
Battery dies, what happens to my money?
It's still there. Charge your phone.
Oh, I know, but I mean, I can't use it.
Well, you keep it charging, Ross. You got 400 million bucks. God forbid you don't have a charger for that.
Hit the home button and shit. Let me
refresh.
So he's going to refresh it. He's going to show you this right here. We're going to do a Bitcoin transaction live on the show, and you can see how quickly and easy this, you know, this brings down borders. You can do business in
you guys are selling PayPal short, right?
PayPal's out of gas right now.
The founders of PayPal are scrambling around to invest in Bitcoin startups, so I bet we'll sell them all.
They should be. That's
Come
what
on, Flipper.
I'm not getting anything. What's refresh?
Come on, you gotta do that.
I'm trying to refresh.
This it's is refreshing.
It's refreshing. It's nothing. It's nothing.
Here's the transaction.
There it goes. So we got there's
I haven't got it.
I got it.
All right, Flipper,
I have too many addresses. Oh wait, what do you say? 0.01 BTC?
Yeah.
Yeah, I got it.
He already has it. There it is.
I was on a different address.
The whole
sorry.
Bitcoin? You sent him the whole coin?
No. I sent him 100th of a Bitcoin, BTC. Which is about
100th. You sent him $2.
$2.
About $3 and something cents.
$3.20.
That's a problem for me too. I don't want 100th of anything. I want Bitcoin, you know. Well,
think of it as being what is that? 10,000 Satoshis.
Oh, there's my wife. I'm in trouble. There's my wife. I gotta go.
All right, we're gonna wrap, right, guys. Definitely a pleasure. Fun having all of you guys. Thank you so much for joining our first ever Cash Cycle. We'll be doing some more of this in the future, and you know, enlightening people more on Bitcoin technology as we go forward. I'd definitely love to have you guys both back.
Yeah, it was a pleasure.
Right, thanks a lot.
Okay. See you guys.
All right, take care, everyone. Right. Have a good night.
Bye. Thanks, everybody. Bye.